Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairperson. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee for inviting me to be in this conference, and also for organizing such a very important event. The title of my presentation today is The Validity Challenge in Psychometrics Assessment. Since psychometrics assessment has been a very important topic now that I've seen, that I've witnessed since coming back to be in Malaysia in 2008. For the next, I think about 45 minutes, I don't think this will go to 1 hour. I will be touching on several areas such as, first I'm going to touch on the introduction to psychometrics, and then the quality, what will be the indicator for a good test. I'll be touching on testing standards and guidelines, and then I will discuss, as we go along, I will discuss about the methodological challenges that test developers encounter during the development of psychometric tests. What you see here is a quotient from a father of modern science that perfectly captures the spirit of psychometrics. He says that Galileo says that we must measure what can be measured and make measurable what cannot be measured. This is completely captures the spirit of psychometrics, which is all about measuring unobservable traits or latent traits that we cannot see. This image perfectly captures all the potential traits that a human being may have. For instance, if you look here at the top of the iceberg, you see skills and knowledge. And below the ocean, you see there are more things that that will explain, that will describe a human being. Usually, when we want to hire people, we want to select people, people will come to the interview room with with their qualification or certification. So those are things that you get to see. You know, like those are the knowledge, those are the skill. But what you cannot see will be those that below the ocean. You know, what would be their ability, what would be their aptitude, what would be their personality, interest, principles, values, as well as motivation. These are some of the attributes. There are, of course, a long list of attributes. I have been approached by so many people that voice their concerns how when they hire an employee, during the interview session, the employee seemed to be doing very well. You know, so the employee seems to be very, motivated, seems to be very good. But once this candidate joined the workforce, it turned out to be something else. You know, it's not as good as what these people say. And there are CEOs of companies that mentioned to me, like, they hired people from good universities, but then when these people come to work, their qualification, the performance, their performance doesn't reflect their qualification. So, so these are the things that that psychometrics technique and methods can be used to measure all these traits. The term psychometrics. There are so many different definitions for this term. You can find it, in Wikipedia, in everywhere in books. They explain the meaning. So what it is actually the science of psychological and educational measurement. It consists of psychometric principles, theory, and technique of educational and psychological measurement. So that's what psychometrics is. And psychometrics is being applied in so many different areas, not only in education, but in health, in agriculture, in ICT is being applied across so many different disciplines. Here, the slide shows the potential, some of the application of psychometrics. It can be used for risk assessment to know, you know, even the traffic planning risk, to know what is the risk, health risk, social risk. All these are using psychometrics technique. It can be used for consumerism, you know, like to know what would be the preference of the market, okay? For instance, before big companies, industries produce, release any products, they would make sure they do, like 3 years before they release the products, they would have started doing surveys and utilizing the psychometric techniques to make sure that they really capture what would be the interest of the market. So that's why we see some companies reduce, they produce products that, you know, 100% that people will be, the society will, you know, line up, queue to buy all these products. So they are really utilizing the advanced prediction method. For monitoring, you want to know, you want to measure integrity, safety, fraud, money laundering. To know potential, you want to know the potential of, you know, talent, and also for human profiling. So in the field of education, it's mostly being used for human profiling, I suppose, yeah? And with the launching of the SBA, school-based assessment, so psychometric is one of, I was told that psychometric is one of the components. So now let's go to the, you know, like application. What actually makes a good test? And I'm sure many of the audience here today know what makes a good test. That is, the test must, you know, have good reliability. So when people talk about reliability, even lawyers talk about reliability. They will say, you know, like, everywhere people will talk about reliability. That means people, it has the connotation of consistency, okay? Repeatability, that's what reliability is. It measures the extent to which the test is effectively measuring anything at all. Okay, and then validity is the second quality indicator. That is the extent to which the test is measuring what it is supposed to measure. So these are the two most important things that usually people make sure that test developers in our country, mostly are done by Lembaga Peperiksaan Malaysia, Majlis Peperiksaan Malaysia, or any other institutions or organizations that produce exams. So these are test developers, okay? And I like this diagram because it shows, you know, it perfectly captures, combine the use of reliability and validity. Like if you look at this one up here, all the dots, you know, are out there, it's not in the middle here. This is unreliable and invalid. So it goes everywhere, and it's not valid because the area that we want to capture is that in the middle there. And this one is unreliable, but valid because we have one dot there. This is reliable, but valid. The reason why I say reliable, because every time it's hit, it goes to the same area within certain boundaries. And this is both reliable and valid because it goes straight inside there. So we want this idea, this concept, we want to bring to our test, to developing our test. The test that we develop, or the test that we use, okay, most of the people here are test users. Okay, you can be teachers in schools, you can be, you know, you can be stakeholders, people who want to make decision whether you want to give scholarships or not. So you are the test users. So you want your test to be like that because, you know, like, so it's hit exactly to the what you want to measure. If we say that this test is, let's say, take for example, an achievement test like biology, okay? If a student score very high on a biology test, that means the test, and assuming that the test is measuring, as you know, with high reliability, and then And the development of the test really follows the standards of validity. So, you know, your test is has high predictive power, okay? So if you choose a student that score very high in biology, this student will be very good throughout the in biology, you know, like you can make prediction. So see the importance of reliability and validity. The concept of validity, actually validity is the most important, the fundamental concept in test development. Here I quote, I would say, you know, people refer to him as like the father of validity, okay? This is Samuel Messick, you know, that was quoted in 1989. He defined validity as an integrated evaluative judgment of the degree to which empirical evidence and theoretical rationales support the adequacy and appropriateness of inferences and actions based on the test scores or other modes of assessment. What this is saying, to some people this may sound like jargon, okay? But what it means here is that validity is actually is a process of gathering evidence. Evidence must be theoretical evidence. Evidence can be empirical evidence, okay, to support the adequacy and appropriateness of whatever conclusion that you're going to make based on the test. Or in other words, whatever action you're going to make based on the score of the test. For instance, if we're giving out a test and the test is supposed to be, you know, based on the results, students are going to be admitted into university or they may not be able to get into university. So test developers as well as test users must make an effort to make sure that we have sufficient evidence to make sure that, you know, we meet the standards that have been established for the validity. The reason why this is very important, especially in the Western countries, because they can be open to lawsuits. Okay, my experience working for educational testing service, we psychometricians have always been reminded of the potential lawsuits that can come to us for if we are careless in our work. You know. So it is to that extent. So, I think it is important that people pay attention on the validity. That is the famous quote by Messick. Okay. So remember. So it is a process. Okay. It's a process of gathering all the evidence. That is what validity is. Based on the definition given by established standards by ARA, APA, and NCME. This was published in 1999. This is a simplified version of what Messick's paper wrote. So the validity is the degree to which evidence and theory support the interpretation of test scores entailed by proposed users of tests. So let's say you are a teacher in school and you know you have started to use tests in schools now, and you know you have been briefed on the purpose of the test, and you want to make sure you understand the purpose of the test and you follow exactly what is the instruction of how to administer the test. It cannot be that you receive a test that you're supposed to administer and then you change the way of the administration to suit whatever situation you are in. When you do that, you have violated the validity of the test. So you see how important the validity is. It's actually the core value there. Validity, the word valid actually is being used even by lawyers. Okay, sometimes you hear the word, people say this is not a valid contract. You know, sometimes people say, employers say, oh, my staff didn't give a valid reason. It is not logic at all, you know. So people use valid, the term valid, in so many different contexts. In the context of a test, okay, as I mentioned just now, it's about, you know, judgment or estimate how well a test measures what the test is supposed to measure. Because we make that definition, so we need to make sure we find evidence to support that it's measuring what it's supposed to measure. No test or measurement technique is universally valid. What it means here is, if you have developed a test for a grade 4, okay, darjah 4, year 4, you have developed a test for year 4, you cannot assume that the test can easily be used for year 5 until you have done, the test developer has done a research to show in whatever ways, it could be the curriculum is almost similar, you know, like, so you cannot simply use test and use the results from the test for whatever, you know, to suit whatever your needs are. It is not as simple as that. If you want to follow the standards, that's how the standard is. Okay? The validity of the test is affected by the culture or by as time changes. Okay? That means if a test that you have been using for the past 10 years, it doesn't mean that the test still has the validity, it's still valid now, okay? So that is why I believe, you know, people, the test developers, those people working for the ministry, the Lembaga Peperiksaan and all Majlis Peperiksaan, that's what they have been doing from time to time to ensure that the validity is checked, you know, as ongoing check on validity. Here, what makes a test valid? Okay, a test will be valid if you have, you gather all the evidence to justify why you are using the test for the proposed interpretation, how you're going to use the scores from the test for whatever reasons you may have. There must be evidence, okay? So who should provide this evidence? It's a question. Who should provide this evidence? Is it the test users or is it the test developers? Okay, those people who are responsible to provide this evidence is the test developers. People who publish the test, they must provide the evidence, okay? Majority, mostly they must provide the evidence. But if test users, like say teachers in schools, want to be innovative, you know, because innovation is the song that has been played, you know, all the time, over and over again. So teachers want to be innovative and teachers change the, you know, the way how a test that has been given by the test developer, they change the format, change the language, they translate into another language, they take a test, like say from UK and translate into Malay. Okay, think it, when they do that, what they are not aware of is that they have violated the validity if they do not take the measures to ensure that the constructs that have been measured by these tests in English and English are the same. Okay, so these are the guidelines. The guideline is there to help you to make sure you have done the necessary action in order to keep, to maintain the validity of the test that you have, okay? So that is why decision makers and policy makers, is very important for decision makers and policy makers to really understand what validity is. Because for psychometricians, those people doing the work in the offices, they will know the technical aspects of it, how to achieve those evidence, okay? But the decision makers and policy makers need to know how important this validity is. If the validity is screwed, actually you have violated, you know, like all the very foundation of test, using test as a mode of assessment. Okay? The second use of a test is to evaluate the extent to which proposed interpretation, that, okay? The first stage is you want to gather all the evidence to justify why you are using this test for what, okay? and why you think this test can be used for that decision making. Okay, the first one is gathering evidence. The second one is to know to what extent this evidence that you gather is appropriate to support the whatever interpretation that you want to make. Okay, so these there are two usage of validation. So among the psychometricians, you know, in the whole world, they can be those people that who are doing one. They can be those people who are doing two. But mostly people will do both. Okay, I mean, this is in terms of the usage. These are very much interrelated. Okay. The responsibility or to validate is actually the responsibility of both test developer and test users. So as a test user, we know that when we buy cars or we buy any electrical equipment, what do you get other than the equipment? You will also get the manual, right? You get the manual how to use it. How to use, you know, like you know, like what, you know, the manual will tell you how to operate it and then what to do, what not to do, right? So the same thing, when test developers produce or test publishers, they produce tests, they need to also supply the test manual, okay? That in itself, you know, is provide another, one form of like, people will be able to understand better what is the proposed intention or proposed use of the test. Okay, and then if let's say the test user, teachers in school or everywhere, anywhere, they want to do some local validation studies. Okay, so they want, because they want to change the format, they want to change the instruction, they want to change the language, or they want to change the content, they must do a validation study. They cannot simply change it and then give it to the student. And then what more if the results is going to be high stakes and the impacts are going to be big? Like, you know, people may not, may be put in certain category that may delay, that may stop them from advancing in their studies or in their career. So this is the awareness, especially in our country, when we are, you know, our language, the, our mother tongue is Malay, so many people tend to, and usually when we do a test, most of the people will understand better if the questions are in Malay. So if we want to use an instrument from another language, we must make sure we carry out the proper, you know, studies to make sure that the, we will end up with valid interpretation of the test. There are many types of validity, okay? So if you study in the academic, you know, if you're doing your master's, you're doing your PhD, or even your bachelor degree, if you're studying education, I believe that you will be, they will touch on the topic of validity, you know, in the course educational measurement. So the first one is face validity. Face validity is more related to public relations than to the psychometric soundness, okay? What it means is that it's, you know, it is how the test takers or test users perceive the test, okay? That is what face validity is. And usually in practice, when we develop a test, we thought, we usually skip this part because we thought, you know, by us only looking at the test, we is already achieved the face validity. By right, we should make sure before we use any test, we are going to get the opinion of the public and, you know, see the reaction, what they think of the test that is being used. Okay? Face validity is often seen from the perspective of test takers. Okay? When test takers or test users can be parents, can be, you know, anyone who use the test, if they don't have confidence in the test itself, they look at the test and they say, how these kind of questions are being asked, I don't think this is going to be, you know, this is fair to my child, or I don't think this is good enough to make such a conclusion. If they have that kind of comments, what will happen is that will affect the motivation of the students, you know, to take the test, because they probably have heard their parents saying, criticizing the test. So it will affect the motivation. So the cooperation, you will get parents' objection. Okay, so this is related to, that's why face validity is related to public relations than the psychometric soundness itself. Okay, a test that doesn't have good face validity can still be valid, okay, can still be used. All right. The second type of validity that I would like to talk about is a judgment of how adequately is content validity. Content validity itself is actually a judgment of how adequately a test samples behavior or content areas representative of the universe of behavior or content areas that the test was designed to sample. Okay, so what it means here, okay, this is also related to the course itself. Let's say during the semester or the penggal, okay, the distribution, the weight of the topics, different topics that will be taught by teachers, okay, are not the same. So when you develop a test, you must make sure the test that you come up with in some way represent the distribution of the time that actually been spent teaching the course itself. Okay, so this is what content validity is. And usually people, teachers, test developers use blueprint, yeah, blueprint or test specifications. This is where you want to check whether you have covered the different types of topics or subtopics, you know, and also you also want to know the different level of cognitive level of thinking. It can be, you know, like difficult or, you know, more difficult, easier, and so on. Usually, people think, okay, from our experience when we develop a test. Usually, test developers tend to think content validity can just be done by them. Okay, they will say they want to skip because they have deadlines to meet. Okay, so they want to skip the part where they want to know how good is their content. Okay, so they will just, they themselves going to look at the test blueprint or test specs, and they're just going to say, okay, this one is valid because we take it for granted. Okay, but there are, when you are developing a good test, you also want to have a group of experts, okay, that will rate each item, okay, that will make a decision whether that item is essential to have in the test, or that item is useful but not really essential, whether that item is not necessary to have on the test at all. So there is you can calculate the rater agreement when you do this rater to find out about the content validity as well. Okay. The next validity, which is also called the umbrella of validity, the most important one, is construct validity. Construct validity. What is a construct? Okay. A construct is whatever the thing that you want to measure, actually. That's in a layman, it's actually whatever that you want to measure. Okay. So construct validity, the definition is about the judgment about the appropriateness of inferences drawn from test scores regarding individual standings on a variable. Okay. So example, you want to, the construct can be creativity, the construct can be motivation, it can be integrity, so anything that you want to measure, okay, in your test. So there are two types of validity. Okay. First is convergent validity. This can be a refresh for your, you know, courses, graduate degree level course. Convergent validity, where we gather evidence for construct how that test, the score from that test, actually, you know, is correlated with the score from another test that measure the same thing. Okay, let's give an example. Let's say we have a test A, which is measuring creativity, and then we have a test B that is also measuring creativity, and we find the correlation between them. If they are highly correlated, then you know it's good to say that they have achieved that convergent validity. The next one is discriminant validity. Okay, discriminant is it shows a little or no significant relationship between test scores on one test and other variables that are theoretically not related. Okay, it can be the test scores itself with another variable as well. And one technique that has been introduced is multi-thread, multi-method matrix, where you find the correlation between the traits within methods and across methods. You know, like you may have, you want to assess your, let's say, your student's performance, okay? You want to assess your student performance by not only using a test that you develop, but also you want to assess the student's performance by using another teacher's evaluation as well. So you want to correlate because the purpose is the same. You want to measure the performance in the same area, the same subject, and you find the correlation between these two. That is one example of the use of multi-trait, multi-method matrix. So psychometricians will know how to do this. Yeah. And in the work context, okay, in the work environment, for instance, you have your KPI, okay, your performance evaluation at the end of the year. Your boss gave you a rate, you know, like a rating of, let's say, 3.9, okay? And your boss also want another boss, okay, who is also another layer, to rate you as well. So then we find the correlation between these two. So that will be the results for this, and see whether there is a relationship or not. If it has high relationship, then it has high convergent validity. Okay, so that is what it means by multi-trait, multi-method. This can be very highly technical, yeah? And then threats to construct validity. Okay, what can actually affect our construct validity? One is underrepresentation of the constructs. For instance, the assessment is too narrow. Okay, you don't really cover the whole area that should be indicators of that particular construct. Okay, that is why before we start developing a test, we will do something that is called test conceptualization. You will come up with the framework, you will come up with the definition. You want to make sure you do not leave out anything that is important to describe or to measure that particular construct. Yeah? And the second one is construct relevant variance. Okay? This is another threat where the assessment is too broad. Okay, you assess on such a big topic, okay, and then you make a conclusion which is very, you know, very specific conclusion, but you went and assess such a broad topic. So that is also another problem, can cause problem. Another one is guessing. If the test takers, if the tests are not written properly, item writing are not written, you know, like you don't really train your item writers to write good items, you know, to know what should be the distractors. You know, like, if you don't train them properly, what will happen is that the students, the test takers, can easily get the right answer by just guessing. Okay? That is also another threat to the construct validity. The other type of validity is criterion-related validity. This is related to, you know, how a test score, okay, can be used to infer how adequately a test score can be used to infer an individual's standing on some measure of interest criterion here, such as grade, examination, or performance. Okay, so there are two types of criterion related validity. For instance, the first one is concurrent validity, and the other one is the predictive validity. Let's say the concurrent validity, let's say I want to measure multiple intelligences. Okay, I want to measure multiple intelligences because I saw a lot of earlier presentations on multiple intelligences. When you want to measure multiple intelligences, you're using a test, your test, that is called test A. Okay? In the market, there is also another test that is also measuring multiple intelligences, and let's call that test B. Okay? Assuming that both of these tests are using the same, thing that they are measuring, you can do a correlation between the score that being obtained from test A and the score from test B, and you see if the correlation is, because they're supposed to be measuring the same thing now, okay? So if they're supposed to be measuring the same thing, the correlation that you find should be high, right? Because then that one is an evidence of concurrent validity. So that's why when we develop a test, if you notice, sometimes a test, a test developer would announce that things like these tests, MBTI, for instance, I'm just giving an example. This is, may not be true, but I'm just giving an example. Let's say they said MBTI, MBTI is another test that is developed based on the theory of type, okay, type theory, Carl Jung theory. So they, let's say the correlation between MBTI and correlation between another test that is also measuring the same thing, they are very high. That means that they are measuring the same construct, and that's why their value of their correlation is very high. Okay? So if you produce a test, if you're a test publisher or test developer, you always want to, at some point, to achieve this concurrent validity. Another one is predictive validity. This is the degree to what your test, okay, predicts some the relationship between the criterion and then and the score. Okay? For instance, if we take SPM, okay, if we do a study, let's say we want to do a study on predictive validity of, I find it easier to give example of the national exam because I think it's more related to the audience. Let's say the test is on chemistry, okay? Assuming that the things that are being measured during the SPM, the curriculum, in the curriculum, and the asasi time or the matriculation time, there's also chemistry subject, okay? So if assuming they're the same, the constructs, they may not be the same here, okay, because the level is different. Assuming they are the same, if they do well in chemistry in SPM, they would also do well in chemistry when they are during matriculation time, okay? Or another example, if let's say a person who gets very high CGPA at the university, right, graduated with 3.93 of CGPA, and then you would think the 3.93 will be able to get a good job and do very well in the workplace. But then what you find may be different. It's the other way around. So then the predictive power of the CGPA is not good enough to predict the work performance. And of course here we assume that when they are in the university, the graduates, the students are being taught how to behave in the work setting, okay? So that's why there are a lot of cautions need to be made before you make any conclusion. There's a lot of things you need to consider first. You cannot simply make the conclusion. And test, now I'm going to the test standards and guidelines. These are the established standards. Standards are done to ensure that we produce sound and ethical use of tests and to provide basis for evaluating the quality. That's why standards is there. And the famous standards, okay, here are some of the established testing standards and guidelines, okay. The standards are done by, we have one standard by ARA, APA, and NCME. We have another one by ETS, okay, that is being used at ETS. And we have guidelines being published by International Test Commission, okay, guidelines being published by BPS, okay. and we have guidelines by the APS. So these are the standards are there, guidelines are there to help us, to guide us so that we will achieve the same level of the quality of testing just like the rest of the world. Okay? So I believe that you know, the Malaysian, all the test developers, test publishers in Malaysia are aware of all these standards. Because when you want to put the standards on, let's say you want to do online testing, there is a standard that you need to follow. It's been published. It's been, you know, they said that certain font type need to be used, certain size. So there is standards for all this, okay? Why do we have all these standards? Because we want to ensure fairness, actually, you know, fairness in testing. Now, the practical part, okay, when we develop a test, there are several stages that we have to use, we have to do. First is the test conceptualization, as I mentioned earlier. In this stage, what are the questions that test developers should be asking themselves? They should be asking themselves, what is the test designed to measure? Okay? I'm very sure test developers are very clear of what they need to do, but sometimes things happen along the way. The test is developed for purpose A, but you know, after a few months, the test is used for purpose B. Okay? I think we see that a lot, you know, in certain areas. What is the objective of the test? The test developers must be very clear. And then, is there a need for this test? Why do we need this test? Okay? Who will use this test? These are the questions that you should ask. Who will take this test? For what purpose would this test be used? What content will the test cover? How will the test be administered? All these test developers must know upfront before they start developing the test. Okay? What is the ideal format of the test? Should more than one form of the test be developed? This is the part where you need to know whether the test that you're going to give to the people, will there be issues of security? Okay? Let's say this is a test that will, because when we have multiple forms of a test, usually multiple forms is done because we want to ensure security. We don't want, we do not want, like, you know, like some, if let's say it's a large area and one test is being done at this point and the next day it's going to be done at another point, there may be some breach of security. Okay? So you need to decide how many forms you want to have. And then what special training will be required for test users? So I believe, you know, I've seen it, like how the Lembaga Peperiksaan Malaysia has, you know, with has trained people to how to, you know, teachers or train the master trainers how to administer the test and how to make the interpretation. So that is, at this stage, they already make plans for that. And then what kind of responses will be required of test takers? You want to know who benefits from an administration of this test. And then is there any potential harm as the result of the administration? For instance, the test is going to supposed to be used for purpose A. You cannot, like after that, you change the purpose. You change it to purpose B. Okay? So, you know, that all this need to be very well known by the test developers. And sometimes, of course, our hands are tied, you know. There are certain things that sometimes we cannot change the decision. Okay? How will the meaning be attributed to scores on this test? Okay? This is the time when we want to know whether the test is going to be used to compare a student from the peers, okay? Or to compare the student from the peers in terms of certain ability, okay? Whether it is, or to, you know, to compare the student to peers in the whole population or compare the student with peers in terms of one specific ability or skills, okay? So there are, at this point, the test developer must know whether this test is a criterion reference test or this test is a norm reference test. Because if they know, then they know the, how to develop them will require different things, you know, different emphasis on different top, different issues. All right, I'm not going to go into the detail for that one. The second one is test construction. Okay, after you have done, you are clear about stage one, now you're doing stage two. This is when you're going to start writing items. You're going to identify the content to be tested. You're going to identify the format, the best format that you should use for the different content, different type of questions that you have. Because for certain constructs, they're very tied to the certain format only would be best to measure them. So it's not something like you can, anything you can do A, B, C, D, the multiple choice. You have to know for which construct it is suitable, for which it is not. Yeah? And then what type of scale to be used? Do you want age-based scale? Do you want grade-based scale? Or you want standardized scale? So all this you need to know at the test construction level. Psychometricians will be helping you with all this because they are there to be the one handling this technical aspect, because the test developers who are the subject matter experts may not be aware of this, these issues. And then you also need to know the type of scoring you use, whether it is cumulative scoring that you want, or you want class scoring, or you want iterative scoring. So these are the things to be considered. Okay, and you also want to know whether your test is going to be unidimensional scale or multidimensional scale. For instance, this diagram shows vectors of actually each arrow represent questions on a real test. Okay, so here we have several questions. I think we have about 20 questions on a test. Okay, this is a math test, and you see that this is represented. You see there are theta 1 is this area. There are theta 2, there are theta 3. Each theta represents different dimension or different construct. Okay? For instance, if you have a math test, the math test is supposed to be measuring the math ability. Okay? But what happened was, let's say a student cannot answer the test because of they cannot read. Okay? So they cannot read well. So this person failed to answer the question just because the student cannot read well. So that's a confounding, that there's a, not just one dimension. Your test is not measuring only one question, one thing. Your test is also measuring the ability to read, okay? So that when they're using multidimensional model, okay, I was told that since I last left ETS in 2008, I was told that ETS has started to implement multidimensional scoring, you know, scaling when they, for global tests. Okay, so that's why they're moving in the United States. Actually, you know, they are moving towards multidimensional now, because you get to see. So once one test can give you three different scores now. Okay, this is what happened in practical. So one test gives you three scores. So you get score on reading, score on math, score on, you know, three different dimensions. This is what happens when you see it, when you want to measure the growth. Because you know, like, when students are in tahun dua, okay, tahun dua, year two, when they move to year three, you want to measure what is the growth of this student in this mathematics knowledge, certain area. So you can do this. You use multidimensional analysis, then you'll be able to see the growth. This is what they call it vertical scaling. They want to measure growth across the different grade areas. Okay, I was told I only have 5 minutes. Okay, in this second stage, which is test construction, test item, you need to do item writing, right? So you need to make sure the questions that you ask will address whatever ability will hit the target, you know, like that chart I showed earlier. You want the question to address, to know very well what is the ability of the student. If let's say, assuming that every question that we have on the test can give you a score that differentiate between each of us here. Let's say all of us in this hall, we take one test, okay? And each question in the test can tell us a part. That means not only 0 and 1, but it can tell where we are in the ability of continuum, in the continuum ability. You know, continuum ability can go from minus infinity to positive infinity. So if each question can tell you where you stand, isn't that wonderful? So you get to know very well where you are instead of knowing, oh, I get a zero for that, I get a one score of zero and one. This concept, okay, this what you see here is what we call item information, which is being used in modern psychometrics, okay? The peak here is the place where the item can measure the best, okay, at which ability. So if you go look at the peak, it might perhaps be a little bit slightly more than zero, okay? This is a standardized scale. And so, you give this question to a candidate, then you know already that the candidate this question measure very well at this point, okay? So all the other areas, okay, it will be very far from the area where it is the top. So this, at this peak, okay, at this area, this is what people will call a difficulty. Don't know why this thing is going down. Okay, the place where an item works best is called its difficulty. This is actually from the item response theory, which is the modern psychometrics. Yeah. The third stage is to pilot test your items, okay? You want to pilot test your items, you want to make sure the environment for the pilot test will be the same as the environment when you want to do the actual testing, okay? You need to make a decision, the number of people you want to try this out, okay? And then the fourth stage is item analysis, okay? Item analysis, there's a lot of things. This is the part where psychometricians get very excited, okay? Because this is usually where the psychometricians get to, you know, do a lot, like have their say, okay? So you will make sure you have, you will count the difficulty index for every item, discrimination index, item validity index, item fairness, okay? You want to make sure the item is not biased, okay? Not biased against any test takers. The bias can be, bias can be because of the item actually would give advantage to those people who come from certain ethnic groups, can give advantage to those because of that person come from different gender, okay? So you want to make sure your item is free from all these bias. There are statistical procedures how to identify diff. And then you want to also, for those who are familiar with modern psychometrics, you want to start using item characteristics curve. So this is where this item characteristics curve can also help you identify diff, okay? For the pattern that you see, you get to know that, and also you get to know whether your question measure the best at which point, yeah? And then qualitative item analysis is the stage where you may want to interview, okay? This is based on the tryout, okay? You want to interview those people who administer the test in the first place. You want to have their opinion, you want to hear from teachers what they think of the question. This is qualitative. You want to talk to the students, what they feel of the questions. So this is the qualitative item analysis that must be done, okay? Before you actually roll out the test. And then there is a sensitivity review, okay? You will have a panel that will look, that consists of minorities, okay? In among the panel that will make sure that the questions are not, do not advantage certain group of people only. So these are among the things that you have to fulfill before the items goes out. There are two types of analyses that can be done. It can be the classical test theory, or it can be the modern psychometrics. This is the modern one, okay? So usually, because of the advancement of technology, this thing, by using this new theory, okay? Actually, this new theory is done because of this old theory cannot meet certain assumptions, okay? That is why we have the new modern psychometrics theory. And because of the advancement of computer, and because of the existence of this theory, we can do computerized adaptive testing, which is called tailored testing, where you get the question based on your ability. The idea is, if the student is not smart, okay, why do you bother to give the student so many questions that that measure high ability level in terms of that continuum? If the student's ability, the intelligence is, let's say, plus 0.1, okay, that means the student can answer a question at plus 0.1 very well. But if your questions, your test, consists of so many questions that measuring are suitable for plus 3.0, definitely the student cannot answer those questions correctly. You're just going to make the students feel frustrated, right? So let's say the same thing, if you have a student that is so smart, the intelligence is plus 2.1, but you give all the questions, which is 0.1. So you don't like get straight to the point. This is the concept that is being used by examinations such as the GRE, okay, Graduate Record Examination, and then examinations like NCLEX, okay, examinations like MCAT, Medical College Admission Test in the United States, they use this concept. That is why when you go in and take the test, you think you go out of the test and then you'll be talking to your friend and say, oh, that question three is so difficult, you know, like, how do you answer that one? Your friend may not have the same question as you, okay? Because the computer, the system already calculate that intelligence, you know, and give you different kind of questions. This control copying, cheating, because you cannot cheat, you cannot copy the one next to you because the questions will be different. This is, by looking at this slide, okay, this guy is saying, for a fair selection, everybody has to take the same exam. Please climb that tree. Okay? So definitely, this test is going to be an advantage to the monkey. Right? So this is the idea of test fairness. So there are so many things that you need consider to consider in order to make a test fair. So one of the procedures to ensure the test is fair, you will have a statistical procedure called test equating, all right? So you people taking different tests, but the score can be comparable, can be compared, all right? I'm not going to go into the technical explanation, but this is the purpose why we have test equating. Actually, many people have approached me asking me what is the purpose of test equating. So the purpose is just to ensure that the score is comparable. If, let's say, some teachers in school, I myself was a teacher, okay, before I changed my career, in a way, so I was a teacher. I remember when I was in school, me and my chemistry, I was teaching chemistry, me and my chemistry partner, we plan, we make plans, we say, okay, so since my test, my class is going to have the test on Monday, your class is going to have the test on Wednesday, let's have two forms of the test. At that time, I was very naive because I didn't really know that there was such thing as there will be difficult items, you know, for different students. You know, because we cannot validly compare the difficulty if we don't do a statistical procedure that is called equating. At that time, me and my colleague, we just compare roughly, okay, this is questions like this, you know, like we just make that rough because we didn't know at that time. And then the final stage is test revision, okay? Item may, based on the pilot test, you may want, and after the analysis, you want to throw away your item, you want to you want to revise the item, so there's so many other things that you can do. So the conclusion, okay, conclusion is, for validity alone, there are 24 standards, actually, established standards in the ARA APA book, okay? Validity is the most important, actually, the most important thing that we want to consider when we develop a test, because the validity here covers not only the use, the development of the test, to the scoring, to the administration, to the scoring, but it also covers how the test is being perceived by the public, okay? How the test is being accepted by the public, how the test is being, the test course is being used. So validity covers it all. So we want to be able to say that the target of all test developers is to say that our test is, you know, following the, all the standards that are on this for test development. And my final thoughts is, we know that validity is a complex property that must be established based on evidence. So from now on, I think, you know, we can all, when we develop a test, we should set our mind, we should start collecting the evidence. The evidence is not sufficient by just doing structural equation models or by doing, you know, by just doing factor analysis. That is just one aspect of it, yeah? And validity has many different aspects that need to be kept in mind throughout the test development process. Yeah? When the test is applied to a new population or for a new purpose, its validity must be re-evaluated in the new context. Validity is an evolving property, okay? And validation is a continuous process, continuing process. And with that, I thank you and I welcome any questions if people have any questions.
So is there any question?
Yes.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Dr. Haniza Yoon, thank you for the very thorough explanation on validity. My concern is, where would you locate the psychometric assessment in the context of school-based assessment? Okay. And is there any suggestion on ways to provide a valid and psychometrically sound measures in the school-based assessment? We want to see the link between the validity in what you have discussed in school-based assessment. Okay. Thank you.
All right, thank you. The first one was maybe I should address the second one first because the second one you were saying that correct me if I'm wrong, you're saying that how psychometric, how the in the current SBA school-based assessment, how we can develop a sound instrument to measure that, the psychological part, okay. Maybe this is your first question, right? This is your first question? Second, okay. All right. So I'm very sure the officers at the Ministry of Education, they have addressed some of the aspects of validity that can be achieved, you know, prior at this stage. Because I'm sure they still need to do a predictive validity study, okay? And they still need to carry out concurrent validity study, as I mentioned, all the different types of, you cannot pick and choose, you know. Every test that you publish, you must have all those. You must have evidence to support each of the steps, each type of validity that as I mentioned earlier. Okay? And I think if you follow the standards clearly, and then, you know, like, I would suggest also that the best place to refer to is actually the article by Messick. Okay, it describes Messick article describes test validity in a very good way, and I also see it being implemented guideline by ETS, for instance. You know, they cover all that in the Messick's article. So if you address all that, I think you can. It's already been achieved. So, but one of the standards for tests is like test developers and publishers is a must for them to make it transparent. You know, they must make it transparent how they achieve all those evidence, okay? So they may not reveal some sensitive data, but they must reveal how they achieve all those evidence, okay, standards. So that is what the most important thing. And of course, there are reasons, you know, like in certain countries, there are certain data that cannot be revealed because of the policy of the country, okay? And the design of the test in the country also is determined by the policy of the country. Like, for instance, in the United States, they must, you know, reveal the questions to the public every year, but They can, but they don't reveal like all of them, but they also have certain portion that is kept as anchor item. That's what the test equating, because anchor item is to make sure, let's say you are taking this test this year, in 2013, you get 9 A's, okay? And you get 9 A's. You want to compare your score with someone, your brother who took the test in 2006, also got 9 A's. We can make the claim that they have the same ability, okay? But if you do not have anchor items, okay, you cannot make such claim, okay? So that is why most of the testing programs in the United States, they have anchor items. That is why they can really compare, make a valid comparison. If you do not have anchor items, you cannot make such comparison, okay? I'm not very well versed with, how this it is in our country. For your first question is how psychometrics tests can be used in the school, in SBA. Psychometrics tests can be used to measure the interest, okay? Interest of students, inclination, which direction they're moving to. It can be used to measure the preferred learning style, okay? Can be used to measure their motivation, their values, okay? The point is, whatever you can measure all this, the chart that I, the diagram, the image that I showed earlier, you can measure all this, but you have to make sure it is valid in the sense that it covers, it address all the points that I mentioned earlier for the validity, what are the things to observe, what are the things, you know, the test users in school, teachers in school must also really understand what is the purpose of this assessment. As we have seen earlier, if teachers in school are not very clear, it can affect the validity of the test as well. I hope that answers your question. We can take it, you know, after this as well. I can take questions after the session too.